My fault. I get joy out of serving the Lord.
Amen.
Hey, man, I appreciate the opportunity to do anything for God.
Amen.
All right, I've got two scriptures I want to read to you before we start preaching. First one's found in Matthew chapter 25, verse 40 and 41. And the second one is found in Job chapter 20. Job chapter 20, verse... Well, we'll tell you when we get there, verse 23. But Matthew chapter 25, look at verse 40. Are you there?
Amen.
If you're not there, look intelligently at the page in front of you and ask your neighbor after it's over, where in the world was he preaching from? All right. Matthew 25, verse 40. And the king shall answer and say unto them, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto one of the least of these my brethren, ye have done it unto me. Then shall he say also unto them on the left hand, Depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. I think I want to preach on the subject of a Halloween party. Y'all remember Steve Schlechte? Did I say that right?
Yeah.
One of the signs that he left around here is the party in hell has been canceled due to the fire.
Amen.
People in America today have got the idea they'll party.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
But the party's over, pal.
Amen.
When you go to hell, the laughter stops. Look in Job chapter 20 and look at verse 23. When he's about to fill his belly, God shall cast the fury of his wrath upon him and shall rain it upon him while he's eating. While the party's going on, God's going to break it up. Now, Zophar was actually deriding Job at the loss of his children. That's what his intention was, to tell Job that while his kids were partying over there in that house, that God broke it up. I think that we could apply that to the land of Sodom and Gomorrah.
Amen.
The Bible said in the New Testament, didn't it?
That
they were eating and drinking as the days of Lot were. They were eating and drinking. But God broke their party up.
Amen.
And Sodom and Gomorrah perished in the fires of hell, if you will. Israel in the wilderness had complained about the manna that God gave them. And so God sent them quail. Y'all remember? But do you remember that he said while the flesh was in their teeth?
Yeah, amen.
While they still eating, the wrath of God fell on them. I suppose the example, number one example in the entire Bible is Belshazzar.
Yeah.
You remember he had a party going on in the fifth chapter of the book of Daniel. But just about the time he thought he had it under control, there came forth the fingers of a man's hand and wrote on the wall, and he didn't exactly write this, but what he said was the party's over.
Yeah, amen.
Amen. The party in hell has been canceled.
Amen.
Due to the fire.
Amen.
Matthew chapter 25, verse 41. Hell was prepared as a punishment for the devil and his angels. That's what its original purpose was. The Bible said in the book of Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, In the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. It didn't say a thing about God creating hell. He created it for the devil and his angels. Now at the creation of the earth, the sons of God and Lucifer was one of them, was rejoicing at the creation of God.
Yeah.
But between then and the Garden of Eden, something happened to Lucifer. And he tried to overthrow the throne of God. And so God, Matthew 25:41, God made hell for the devil and his angels.
Amen.
It's been said if you go there, you'll go as a trespasser. You're not wanted. Amen. Nobody in hell wants you there.
Amen.
You say, well, my brother went. Well, your brother's on my side tonight.
Amen.
I can prove that by the Bible.
Yeah.
You say, well, my daddy's there. My father's there. My uncle's there. My son or my daughter. If they are, they don't want to see you again. Because ain't no party in hell.
Yeah.
Want to preach on that subject. The party's been canceled because of the fire. Our Heavenly Father, thank you today for the privilege to pray. And help me, Lord, to be able to preach the unsearchable riches of Christ, that there is an escape from that awful place called hell. Lord Jesus had bore our sins and our sorrows in His body on the tree that we'd not have to go. Thank you, Father, that you'd supply our need. And Father, we need you. And we confess our unworthiness to you. But we ask you, God, to have mercy on us. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now the party is planned. And the people are invited. The Bible tells us of a list of folks who will be there. The unbeliever will be there. The wicked will be there. They go there by default. You understand? That's where the broad road leads. That's where the wide gate opens to. They go there by default. They don't go there because God intended for them to do that. Now let me talk to you about hell. Hell is real. This old book says it's real. It's not about some shadowy substance of some dark unknown region. But hell, this book describes it as a lake that burns with fire and brimstone. We'll talk about that further later on in this sermon. But with the age of enlightenment, people came out of the, quote, dark ages. And they came out with because the Catholic Church had got so corrupt that nobody would believe what they taught and the indulgences that they sold, that people began to look other places other than the Bible other than, quote, the church for the answer to life's problems. The Age of Enlightenment men began in earnest to use their own wisdom to answer the questions of life. Wisdom is needed. But the wisdom of the world, the Bible tells us, leads to death.
Amen.
Man needs wisdom.
Yeah.
He definitely needs it. But the book said, if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not. If you would like to know something, why don't you ask God?
Amen.
He seems to be the last person that enlightened people want to go to.
Yeah.
He seems to be the last one. No doubt we need to ask somebody. I submit today that you ask God, because God is the giver and granter of real wisdom. You don't necessarily ask the church. Don't even ask the preacher for final authority. Ask God. God's the one. Now in the book of Acts in the 17th chapter in the 22nd verse, let me show you something. I want to talk to you about the Greek there. The Greek there calls people worshipers of devils. Devil worshipers. Now, let me ask you, if you were to run into somebody that was worshiping all kind of weird things, that they were worshiping, and you see them here in the hills of West Virginia.
Yeah.
These people's got all kind of weird ideas about how things work.
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, I've been bombarded with them in the church. You know what I'm talking about? You can't do that. That's bad luck. Now, if somebody would come up to you and tell you that if you find a horseshoe, that's good luck, and you would find a break of mirror, that's 7 years of bad luck. If somebody would tell you that, what would you say those people were? Would you say they were too religious? Or would you say they was too superstitious?
Yeah.
This King James book is the one that says they're too superstitious.
Amen.
The rest of them say they're too religious.
Yeah.
Ask God if you want to know something.
Amen.
Don't ask people.
Amen.
Their definitions and God's definitions don't match.
Amen.
So if you need to know something, ask God.
Yeah.
But they look to other explanations. And because the heathen had different explanations, they remove the fire from hell.
Yeah, that's right.
They remove the brimstone, and they remove the smoke, and they mirrored off all of the excesses of hell, and they've watered it down till it doesn't amount to much.
Right.
But let me tell you something. If you ask God, it has not cooled off one
Amen.
Degree.
Amen.
Hell is hot as it ever was, and the party's over when you get there. The devils danced with glee whenever they thought, well, we'll have a party. One of their days of the year is coming up this week, Halloween.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not stupid. I'm all for somebody giving me candy. Hey, man, I understand that. I understand that little kids can dress up and they go out from door to door and people give them candy. But here's the thing. Whenever we go to making light of witches and goblins and ghosts, and we go to saying there's nothing to that, we're falling into that same superstitious
Amen.
That had that party on Mars Hill.
Yeah.
The party's been canceled. Hell is hot.
Amen.
Lucifer's not running the club. He too will suffer eternal damnation in the lake of fire. Why anyone would want to attend that party, I do not know.
Amen.
It's a fake. It's designed to lure you in, but it's 10,000 times more deadly to your soul than a Venus flytrap is to a fly.
Amen.
It's more deadly. It's still going on. It started when Lucifer rebelled against God, and it's still burning, and it's going to burn for eternity.
Amen.
The wicked will still be there. Amen. Who's going to the party? Psalm chapter 9, verse 17 said, all nations that forget God.
Yeah, right.
The wicked will be turned into hell, and all nations that forget God. Would it be safe to say that America has forgotten God?
Amen.
Would it be safe to say with the prophet Jeremiah, we've forgotten God days without number?
Amen.
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 And the promise of God, not the promise of Obama or Robert Byrd or Jay Rockefeller, but the promise of God is that the wicked will be turned into hell and all nations that forget God.
Amen.
She sits as a queen today, declares that she'll not know any sorrow. Her plagues will come in one day. Her death and her mourning will, her famine will be here. Revelation chapter 18 and verse 8, she shall be utterly burned with fire. Utterly burned with fire. Revelation 21, 8 gives us a list of the tenders of this party. It says the fearful and the unbelieving, and the abominable, and murderers, and whoremongers, and sorcerers,
yeah,
and idolaters, and all liars,
yeah,
will have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9, the Apostle Paul chimed in and said, the unrighteous and fornicators and idolaters and adulterers and effeminate and abusers of themselves with mankind and thieves and covetous and drunkards and revilers and extortioners and the devil and the false prophet, amen, and the beast and a whole nother breed of angels that kept not their first estate. But the sad thing, Revelation chapter 20 and verse 15, whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. If you attend the party or you intend to crash the party, let me tell you some festivities that will be going on. In the book of Matthew chapter 8, verse 12, and then again in the following chapter, verse 13, I think, there will be weeping in one, and in the other there'll be wailing and gnashing of teeth.
Yeah,
the pains of hell seize on a man's or a woman's soul. The sadness and the sorrow, and if they could, hot tears and the unbearable anguish. I can't describe what this Bible teaches about that gnashing of teeth.
Yeah.
I'm not happy about that at all. You know, I see two definitions for that. Number one, I see people falling into the lake of fire who are in such pain that they have to just grind their teeth together to try to help alleviate the pain. And then I see number two, in that lake of fire, there will be people that will just run up to you and just grab hold of you and bite chunks, if it were chunks, out of your flesh.
Yeah.
A daughter will come up to a mom and say, "You're the reason that I'm here."
Amen.
And she'll bite on her mother's arm or wherever she can get hold of. And some dad, maybe some preacher, amen, that said, "It's okay, don't have to worry about the blood atonement." And in the lake of fire, as they burn forever and fall endlessly in the bottomless pit, the partygoers will not be as happy as you think they are. The festivities, I'm preaching about what really goes on there. I'm not preaching about Hollywood's idea. I'm preaching about the sorrow that you'll suffer if you're not saved, or that your children or your mom or your dad will suffer if they go to that awful place. Somebody said, "Come on, old buddy, have a drink." Not in hell you won't have a drink. There was a rich man that begged for somebody to come and just to dip the tip of their finger in water and cool his tongue, for he was tormented in that flame. Not only are they longing for water, but the way I understand the Bible, the lustful things of this life will still have hold on them. Revelation 22:11, "He that is filthy, let him be filthy still." If you got filthy habits here, you'll have filthy habits there. The dopehead will want a fix, but can't get it. The drunkard will want his alcohol, but can't get it. The whoremonger will want his pornography, but can't get it. The smoker will want his cigarette, but can't get it. I'm saying in hell they still lust after the things, but they have no fulfillment. Your sin will be confined just to the desire to get it and can't have. Daniel chapter 12 and verse 2, the Bible said that hell's a place of everlasting shame and contempt. You know, folks aren't ashamed today. There's things that they used to be, amen, they'd be ashamed of. Now they parade it on our television screen and cuss anybody that would speak up against it. But I'm telling you, homosexuality is still wrong. I'm telling you that whoremongering and the things they go are still wrong. That alcohol is still deadly. I'm telling you that dope will still destroy your soul. And I don't care if the whole world agrees with it. God disagrees with it. continual torment, and that one day they'll be ashamed of what they're doing. Now they can't blush. I read in the book of Jeremiah, he was talking about his people that had backslidden and said, God said this, don't look at me. God said this, their forehead was like a whore's forehead.
Amen.
I mean, you couldn't embarrass her.
Amen.
Amen. America's that way today. You can't embarrass them. Amen. Things that used to make them blush, they don't blush anymore. How long's it been since you saw somebody blush? They open up that electric trash can, turn that television on, and all kind of filth comes rolling in their house, and they just sit there. Well, if I'd come over to your house, sit down on your couch, and commence to cuss, you'd say, preacher, you're embarrassing me. Get out of here. Well, you ought to tell that electric trash can the very same thing.
Amen.
Thank you. Amen. I'm preaching about the real things of hell. Shame and embarrassment for what has happened. Continual torment. No rest day or night. I said the party's over. It's been canceled because of the fire. Amen. Hell is a fire. It's a literal fire. I don't care what the modern preacher wants to tell you. It's a fire that burns. It is kindled by the anger of a righteous God. And the Bible said it'll burn to the lowest hell. It'll consume the earth and consume the increase of the earth and set on fire the foundations of the mountains. Eternal blackness and darkness. I think the closest thing that I could describe, have you ever saw a volcano? Have you ever saw the lake of fire that's going on there? When folks say, well, we'll party, how many of you going to jump in a volcano and party? You say, well, we'll be able to, how many of you could see if you jumped in that volcano? Yet it's on fire. Amen. Ashes and cinders forever and ever. Festivities will include swimming, I guess.
Amen.
In a lake of fire. Revelation chapter 19, verse 20. They were cast alive into the lake of fire and brimstone. In Mark chapter 9 and verse 44, the Bible said the fire never shall be quenched. Never. Can you understand that? Do you understand the seriousness of what we're saying? I wouldn't wish my worst enemy to have to go to hell.
Amen.
It never, never shall be quenched. What a fire. Big parties have keepsakes. Amen. Whenever the politicians of Washington, D.C. throw one of their $50,000 dinners, somebody will grab some kind of a keepsake to remember. I actually believe you'll have some things that you can remember when you get there.
Amen.
Number one, you'll remember this sermon.
Amen.
You'll remember that time you sat in Esther Baptist Church and the reaction that you had. Perhaps you sniggered or laughed, or perhaps you thought that crazy old coot of a preacher, he don't know what he's talking about. It can't be that bad, but it can be that bad, and it is that bad.
Amen.
You'll remember that.
Amen.
Whenever you're in the lake of fire. You'll remember that I told you the party's been canceled.
Amen.
I think you'll remember every sermon you ever heard. I think you'll remember every invitation that was ever given. Every time that you sat in your seat or stood there and gripped the back of the seat and rejected the Holy Ghost of God, I think you'll remember it. Perhaps there are people in hell that remember a mommy that prayed for them, or a daddy that prayed, or a husband or a wife that prayed for them. I believe you'll have memories.
Amen.
Amen. You'll remember the layout of this church building. You'll remember how far it was from where you are to this altar.
Amen.
You'll remember that you didn't take the trip, but your conscience will never let you forget.
Amen.
You say, you like that kind of preaching? I don't like it. Do you? I don't preach it because I like it. I preach it because it's true.
Amen.
I preach it because it's my job as a preacher to tell you there's no party going on in hell.
Amen.
Your conscience will not let you forget. You'll remember preaching. You'll remember the Bible that laid on your coffee table when it should have been read. You'll remember the call of the Holy Ghost of God that worked on your heart and you said no. You'll remember Mount Calvary where Jesus Christ died for your sins. He paid the debt that you could go free, and you'll remember that. Now notice what I said, and I'll close. I didn't say the party is postponed. I said the party is canceled. Down here when we plan a big bash, amen, and something will come up to stop it, it'll rain perhaps, and we're aiming outside, and so we'll postpone it. We'll have another date. The party's not postponed. The party's canceled.
Amen.
There's not going to be no party.
Amen.
Are you listening to me? There's not going to be no party.
Amen.
You're going to go to a lake that burns with fire and brimstone, and you'll never ever be able to get out.
Amen.
No escape. In our Job chapter 20, verse 23, while they was eating, while they was having that party, amen, God broke it up. And I said the greatest example that I know in the Bible is old Belshazzar.
Amen.
King of a vast domain, had everything at his disposal, had the vessels of God. He took the vessels of God and he drank wine from them, and he praised the gods of gold and wood and stone. And then that hand of the Lord says to him, party's canceled.
Amen.
But you know the sad thing? You are weighed in the balance and found wanting. Could you imagine that? God's got a scale. Amen. And you're weighed in the balance of that scale. Amen. And you're found wanting. You know what I know? I know that the blood of Jesus Christ can balance that thing out.
Amen.
Amen. And you don't have to go. Why will you die when the sheltering cross is so nearby?
Amen.
Why would anybody choose to go to hell? Prepared for the devil and his angels. I know why they're going. Why would you go? Let's bow for prayer. Oh, listen to me today. There are people who have sat right in this church and heard a gospel preacher preach about the necessity of repentance, about the blood of Jesus Christ. And they thought because they'd been taught in their society, well, if I go to hell, I'll just be with my friends. You won't have no friends. If you go to hell, you'll be alone, lost forever. Well, you say, preacher, I'm not going. Thank God I'm not going. What about your family? What about your friends? What about your loved ones? If we could see the disaster that awaits this party, I don't believe we could sleep until we got them right. Our Heavenly Father.